increasing original sexual assault charges to lesser and related offenses. So today we'll talk more about that. We'll talk and ask questions of one another, we'll challenge each other, and we will be challenged, and that's something that is important with these forums, and is something that and is one of the reasons that we do them. We're honored for you all to be here again. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being interested in the reporting, for reading and hearing. And we hope that you all will continue to come to Carolina Public Press and the local news organizations that are working on this story as it continues. News is being broken a lot. Yes, we have to turn up as well. So we're going to continue reporting about this over time. So please keep coming back to us. And there's a lot of people in this room that can talk about Carolina Public Press. We really do rely on your support, both in terms of reading our reporting and supporting nonprofit news in North Carolina and supporting news, period. Readers are incredibly important. What you say is incredibly important. Like I said, you all often, conversations that we have with you often inspire journalism like you're seeing this week. So find us, talk to us, tell us what you think, and we'll keep listening and talking back. I want to share that we have board members here. Patrick Duran would like to say a little bit.
My name is Patrick Duran. I'm the vice president of the board, and thank you everybody for coming. I'm not going to talk long. It's just been an honor to be part of Carolina Public Press. I've been on the board for almost 3 years. Even as short time as a year ago, it was mostly Angie and Frank pulling the weight on doing the stories for us. In that time, we've really done an effort to have a scope that covers the entire state as opposed to where we started in Western North Carolina. And this is an example of what we're able to do with the resources that we've been able to put together, thanks to Angie and everybody on the staff. So I hope that you're able to keep those coming, but please do follow us and sign up. There's some information on that sign up there and on our website so that we can show that we're reaching the audience that we're trying to reach. And the more audience we have, the more we can talk about that, and the more we can reach more people. So thanks, everybody, for coming.
So with that, I'll introduce our panelists and our moderators. Just a little bit of a change from the handout that you received earlier, but so I'll note that. We have with us Representative Chaz Beasley. He represents Mecklenburg County. We were going to have host Hillary Cooper. She wasn't able to join us tonight. Instead, we have Mary Williams Stover with the North Carolina Council for Women. Thank you for being here, Mary. We have Monika Johnson Hostler, the Executive Director of the North Carolina Coalition Against Sexual Assault. Thank you for being here, Monika. We have Rob Phelan. He's an instructor developer with the North Carolina Justice Academy. And Lauren Schwartz, who's a sexual assault nurse examiner and director of the Solace Center at Interact of Wake County. And we're also joined by Amanda Thompson. She's a laboratory assistant director for administration with the State Crime Laboratory. So thank you all for being here. The panel's going to be moderated by Frank Taylor, who's the managing editor, and Kate Martin, who's the investigative reporter and lead reporter on this project. So we'll do a moderated conversation for about half the time, and then we'll have a Q&A with y'all. And you can ask questions and make comments and talk with the panelists and one another. So thank you again for being here, and I'll let Frank take the lead.
Thank you, Angie. Thank you all for the panelists. Thank you for everybody who's here. We had a great panel last night in Fayetteville, and so we're going to have to see if you guys can remember up to it. Excellent conversation we had last night on Facebook. But no, the series that we've done and the partners we've brought together on this, we've been really excited by the conversations that we've had. Kate led the way with analysis of statewide court data. That is not the end point, and we never wanted to be. It's led to important conversations with people like those on the panel tonight, but people across the state, people from Onslow County to Cherokee County. and everywhere in between, not quite everywhere, but a lot of counties have gone. But certainly all regions of the state. And so we hope this will promote additional conversation, even if people say, I don't believe the word. That's fine, we'd like to hear that too. So I want to begin by asking something of Paul. We kept hearing, we worked on this series, about the importance of forensic analysis and the evidence gathering process in investigating sexual assault. And one of the things that came out repeatedly were officers who said, I had a specialized training, and I remember how I went about this before I had the training. It's night and day, I would never have thought it. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the specialized training that's essential for sexual assault.
Certainly. Is this thing on?
Yep.
First of all, let me congratulate all of you. The fact that my mugshot on the website did not scare you away speaks volumes, so thank you for being here. Some of the training that we offer just at the Justice Academy itself are offered to any law enforcement officer in the state of North Carolina, and sometimes even South Carolina, Virginia. We even have international students, but our priority is North Carolina law enforcement officers. That could be patrol and specific detectives or investigators. And some of those trainings include criminal sexuality, sexual paraphilia, basically the mindset of a sexual perpetrator, investigating sexual victimization of children. Those are some of the classes that are currently offered. Now, aside from the sexual investigation part of it, we also have a forensic analysis instructor who is certified in everything there is to be certified in forensic analysis. Catherine Reynolds is his name. He does actual evidence collection when it comes to sexual assault as well. Now, one thing I wanted to say about that is, as a new training coordinator for the Academy, some of my goals are to introduce additional courses for law enforcement officers and specialized training, some of those being a basic sex crimes investigations course, some of those, one of them being a child and adolescent sex trafficking course. And the final thing worth noting is the recent grant that the state received, 2018 SACI funding, sexual assault kit initiative funding, has specified specific monies for training for law enforcement. And the verbiage in that indicates victim-centered approaches to sexual assault investigation.
So, Monika, thanks for coming. In our interview for this investigation, you told me that you had long suspected that there would be a significant percentage of sexual assault cases that were not being prosecuted. What is your reaction to our data and the investigation?
Thank you, and I will continue to thank you for this coverage. I said today at our press conference, this July 1 is my 20th year working at the North Carolina Coalition Against Sexual Assault. So I've spent 20 years waiting for the moment where people would cover sexual assault in a way that it wasn't about victim blaming or shaming. And so I have to thank you and all of the partners who are part of this process, who are absolutely leading the way in the moment that we're talking about the Me Too era, that it couldn't have been better timed, which you didn't plan that, but I will say to you that it's made a difference for the number of survivors and advocates that have been dedicating their time like to this work. So it goes without saying for myself and the people in this room who do this work, thank you to all of you who have committed to that. So Kate heard me say firsthand, I've spent my entire career saying publicly that the prevalence of sexual violence has often been questioned in every room I've ever been in. And so people make the assumption that they don't know anyone who's been sexually assaulted. And so, of course, as you can imagine, I'm a total buzz killer at a party. Because I always say to people, ask someone you know. Because we make the assumption that we don't know somebody who's been impacted by sexual violence. And then the second thing I say to people is the number of people who've been sexually assaulted in North Carolina have never really seen the face of justice through our justice system. And so I've spent my career working with and sometimes adversarially to every cog and wheel and I call it the legal system to ensure that we're creating a system that can be responsive to sexual assault. And so when I say that people have said I've over-exaggerated the lack of criminal justice outcomes, as I said to you, your analysis, for 20 years of my words, now will come true. Right, that it is an objective party who looked at our state data and is able to verify the things that those that the folks at my Red Crisis Centers work with daily know to be true from the survivors that they hear.
Lauren, I want to talk to you about the role of state nurses in North Carolina, but it's worth noting you're in a unique situation compared to most state nurses, as I understand it. Most of them are working in hospitals. You talked about, wanted to ask you about where you see the system needing to improve on vulnerabilities and the lack of coverage centers. Could you address in particular what's different about what you do compared to those centers?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for having me. I would just like to say as well, I have a few members of our team here who are sitting in the back. If you need at any time to have some support or just to have somebody to talk to, please just step on back, tap them on the shoulder. They'd be happy to talk to you. They are our advocates who are present with all of our survivors when they come in to see forensic nurses. And so my role as a sexual assault nurse examiner or forensic nurse is to see, talk to, treat, examine survivors of sexual assault. What is unique about where I work is that I work in the community setting, so we are embedded within Interactive and Crisis and Domestic Violence Center. I've worked in both the hospital emergency department and in the community-based setting, and I can absolutely tell a difference in just the environment that we're able to provide the patient, really to see them go through this process with us and the hours that it takes to go through the exam makes a huge difference on the patients. I think some of the vulnerabilities in the access to SANE nurses is that there's an extreme lack of SANE nurses nationwide. Here in Wake, we are the second most populous county in North Carolina, and we still don't have enough forensic nurses. We have a team at Interact. I know that there's some nurses who are also trained within the hospital systems. But what typically happens is that the hospitals, law enforcement, community members would refer sexual assault survivors to us in the community setting, and we would be able to see them there. However, there's a lack of nurses. So if there are not forensic nurses available to see them, those clients would end up being seen in the emergency department. So we're definitely trying to increase the number of nurses that we have better access to them. One of the things that complicates access to nurses is that the training can be very extensive. Of course, we want them to be trained really well and be able to provide that high quality care. So the training can be very extensive, very long. Increasing access to SANE nurses definitely takes a lot of dedication and a lot of that training.
I meant to say before I get introduced to you, for those who are not aware, SANE nurses are sexual assault nurse examiners. They perform rape examinations in this case.
Yes, correct.
Representative Beasley, thanks for coming. You introduced some legislation this week. I'm hoping you can talk to us about the issues that it addresses in relation to what we've been writing about.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. It's like great to see so many people here who understand the importance of these issues and why we need to talk about them and why we need to discuss them. So I just want to say from the get-go, while I was one of the authors of this bill, the primary sponsor of this bill, along with three other of my colleagues, I don't consider this bill my bill because this was the direct result of survivors and folks who were advocates for this issue and for these issues coming to us and talking to us. Nobody wants to be a survivor of sexual assault, but if they are and they dealt with the system and they dealt with what's going on, then we should listen if they have found loopholes that need closing. So this bill does four things. Number one, it addresses the taking care of these kids, but they're biologically, legally biologically remote from the children. What this does is it closes the loophole so that DSS can now go into those homes, and if there's an unsafe situation, they now have the tools to investigate and stop things from happening. Number two, we changed the fact that right now in North Carolina it's illegal to put something like a chemical substance, glass, in someone's food, but not someone's drink. We closed that loophole too, so that now commonly it's known as roofing. If you roofie somebody, and I think Monika was saying earlier that she's been using that term for 20 years, and that shows how long we've been dealing with this issue and how much we need to fix it. So if you roofie someone, we're now giving law enforcement the tools to crack down on that. Number three, we're closing the incapacitation loophole. So in North Carolina, if you are drunk or you take medicine, you have an adverse reaction, then you're now mentally incapacitated. Unless you can prove in court that the perpetrator actually did something to you physically to make you mentally incapacitated, it is not second-degree rape or second-degree sexual assault. That has to change. This bill closes that loophole. And the fourth thing, although it is not a legally substantive change, it's still a substantive change for many survivors, is that we're updating the language that we use to talk about sexual assault. In North Carolina, we still call rape in our statutes forcible rape. We still call sexual assault forcible assault. And that can be jarring for a lot of people to hear that when they go into court and they hear this repeated over and over and over. So what we've done is we haven't changed any of the elements of those sexual assault crimes, sexual offense crimes, but we're going to say rape is rape. We're going to have our laws reflect that rape is rape. And so I really appreciate the fact that many of these things were things that were brought to me. They were not ideas that I came up with on my own. They were ideas that many people at this table have been working on for many, many years. And I'm very happy to report that we already have 56 primary sponsors and co-sponsors in the House. We need 61 to get to a majority for a vote. 56 people already. And then we still have two more days for people to co-sponsor this bill. So if you know anybody that hasn't, it's on the website, get them on board, because we definitely want to show, you know, we had two Republicans, two Democrats on this bill. This is a bipartisan bill, and ever since the word, we can actually get this passed. I mentioned earlier, this is not a feel-good bill. This is a bill we can actually make law, we actually get to the governor's desk, but we got to work for it. So I would really encourage all of you to talk to your friends, talk to your legislators about how we make this happen.
Our next question is for our representative from the Domestic Violence Commission, and I apologize, I'm looking at the old program. Remind me of your name.
Mary,
thank you so much. When we talk about the Carolina Domestic Violence Commission, obviously there's an overlap between domestic violence and sexual assault. I'm wondering if you could talk about that a little bit, and then a little bit about what you think as you see these results that we're talking about, one in four defendants or fewer actually end up being convicted in sexual assault cases. From your experience, what do you think of that result? But can you let us know a little bit about the, you know, the connection between these two areas of impact?
Well, thank you. So the Domestic Violence Commission. The Domestic Violence Commission focuses on crimes where there is a relationship, a marital relationship. But we also know that often perpetrators of rape also can, rape can occur in marital situations as well. And also perpetrators
Amanda, could you tell us about the efforts by the Attorney General to improve the process of testing the rape kits here in the state?
Through the criminal justice
level grants?
Yes, sir.
Through you.
That's correct.
Paul, last night when we had the panel from Fayetteville, we talked with John Summernight in Fayetteville, who leads sexual assault investigations. I guess he has the SDU in the city of Fayetteville Police. And one of the things that's very interesting he mentioned about training, he talked about how when he was doing this, say 20 years ago, I'm not sure how many years ago, but a few years ago, if he interviewed a survivor of sexual assault, and the person said, this happened to me, and then later did that, and said, no, it wasn't like that, it was a different time and place. They said, oh, this person's lying and making it up. Thanks to additional training, he realizes, oh, I'm dealing with a trauma brain. And that was a mistake he realizes he made, and many officers will make if they don't have that kind of training. That being one example, what are some of the types of things that you see as mistakes that are made in sexual assault investigations when there's not the right training?
Well, thank you for that question. I forgot to mention earlier, thank you guys for having me. It's an honor to be here. And I'm glad you mentioned trauma. I think one of the reasons the Academy chose to hire me is because I'm finishing my degree in practical trauma counseling, and they felt that I could adequately translate the law enforcement community to the crisis and trauma community. So trauma is something that that is one of the biggest things, is that officers have not been trained traditionally in identifying, is this person currently in a state of trauma? But you mentioned or asked about other mistakes or other things, and one of the common mistakes that law enforcement officers make is to prematurely ask a victim if they are willing to participate in criminal prosecution. Tying that into another mistake is that we, and I'm probably guilty of this in my 16 years of law enforcement investigation experience, is being heard with the investigation. Now, officers need to know, and we as trainers need to teach them that probably the best time to approach that idea of criminal prosecution is after a thorough investigation has been completed. Oftentimes, officers will make that one of their first priorities, and that's a mistake that could translate into victims not willing to proceed further in the criminal justice process. We mentioned earlier blaming. You talked about that back in the day, for lack of better words, especially on the patrol level, that was an issue. When you get into more specific criminal investigators, sex crimes detectives, that's not quite an issue as much as it is on patrol level. I do believe, without having any data in front of me, the blaming of sexual assault victims is dissipating. I'm not naive enough to say that it's not there anymore. However, that common practice, thanks to trauma-informed training, has dissipated in the last decade.
Monika, you've been in this field for quite a while, and I'm sure you have a lot of opinions about what needs to change. I'd love to hear what you have to say.
I have a lot of opinions. You are right, but I mean, attempt to limit them. And some of those, indeed, as Paul just mentioned, are there's movement towards the practice, but we are definitely by far nowhere near. One of the biggest things that I say when and I mentioned this earlier about all the cogs on the wheel, which when I started this training, we used to literally use a wheel, and there were cogs, and so there's a law enforcement cog, there's a prosecutor cog, there's an advocate cog, there's the general public, i.e. jurors cog, and then there's elected officials cog. And those are the real pieces of where I would say, including the advocacy community, there is room for improvement for all of us. And I say that because every single person has a bias to how they immediately respond to hearing rape or sexual violence. One, we're in a country where we've been inundated, since it's in the fabric of our country, talking about sexual violence. In a multitude of ways, we're impacted by that. That's race, class, community. It's impacted families. I'm North Carolinian. And when I took the job straight out of college, my grandmother said to me, people are not going to talk to you about that. That's a family matter. I still hear people tell me that in 2020. we started to start seeing pieces of this break, people were still saying to me then, do you think that this will change? And the thing that I keep saying is that entire will doesn't change until we change the way that we talk about this broadly. Because each of us individually either go in because we have experience with sexual violence, so we believe the survivor, or we believe we have no experience, or it's suppressed. We can talk about trauma in the brain quite a bit also around people not believing they have experience when oftentimes, once they do this work for a while, they do come to most people saying, you know, I just had this moment where I remember that I had a college roommate who did mention this. So all of those things are true. And so those people often come saying, I don't understand this, so I don't believe it because I've never heard of it. And when you have such a dichotomy of thought around any issue, especially an issue that's very personal, then you're going to see how the system has become broken, like the criminal justice system, and the way that we respond as individuals to survivors. And so I think it's important that people understand the cultural landscape that kind of looms underneath the way that we are all responding to or lack of responding to sexual violence. So I think that's the first thing I would say, is this conversation is a really good start to changing the landscape about how people see, view, and experience hearing the word sexual violence. I heard an example that there was also this conversation around the CSI effect. Indeed, I believe that that is some truth, but I tell people all the time, before CSI, there was Law and Order. Before Law and Order, you know, there was ER. There's a show that we can all think of in every generation where sexual violence was built into it. But for whatever reason, that has not really changed how we see sexual violence as a culture. And so I think it's going to take more than any effect to really see a system that's working on behalf of survivors. And I believe this conversation that you all are having across the state will do that. I believe that the Me Too movement will do that. I believe survivors having a voice to own their experience and don't really care what people say in response. I mean, there's survivors who come out on the internet around Me Too, and the backlash they've received has been overwhelmingly horrific to their healing journey. And so I believe each of us individually have a role, but I believe society has to change in order to see law enforcement's going to have trauma in the brain, our prosecutors, every national entity is, the Institute of Chiefs of Police has a trauma brain training that's over a decade old. We're just now talking about it in North Carolina, but it's not new. They hired every researcher who did neuroscience work a decade ago to really create this training. The National Prosecutors Association, also a decade of training around trauma of the brain. And so I think Paul's right. The system was created to say, survivor, do you want to do something? Well, in that moment as a survivor, they don't know what they want to do other than deal with the fact that they were just sexually violated. And so if we just change our immediate response when someone says they were sexually assaulted, that will absolutely change the system. And I mean that both personally, our response, but also collectively, our response to systems. And while that seems very simple, I don't think any of these systems, any training, is really going to impact a system until individuals choose to change the way that we respond when people say sexual assault. If we shut down, there's no way we're going to really see the change that needs to happen for survivors to have full, healthy lives. And that we actually heard from your co-sponsor say today that 40 years ago he knew a survivor and her sexual assault is what ended her life. And people don't really talk about the real impact. Survivor change, we have college students that our legal team represents at NC-CASA, they stopped going to college, right? So we are changing a person's life. 12-year-olds get sexually assaulted. They are not learning when they go to school tomorrow, right? Because we're sending them straight back to school. So, I mean, every facet of every sexual assault case, I can tell you that we hear their lives are forever impacted. And so just the look on our face, the sound of our voice, the inflections, when someone says sexual assault can actually be life-changing for somebody. And they could choose to go forward, and we could choose to change our system just by the way that we respond.
Thank you. by the way, the conversation in Fayetteville may have been influenced by the 288. It was a healthy conversation, but you make a good point. Laura, as we think about the differences in different parts of North Carolina, we talk to people in different parts of the state, particularly about the role of same nurses, the accessibility of same nurses. We heard some interesting stories of people in fairly rural areas, particularly in the mountains, saying we didn't have to drive, this was talking to the Great Crisis Council, we had to drive people a long ways to get to a hospital that has same nurses, particularly certain times of day. Or we drive and, you know, maybe half an hour, which isn't that long. But then we get there and we have to be process if possible that takes forever. But particularly people in these rural areas are describing that. I don't know if you've seen that here. Obviously, we're in an urban area, yet we are surrounded by some very rural counties. And when we did our analysis, we found some of the counties all around Lee County are some of the ones with very low numbers. I grew up in Lee County. Lee County had, in our study, had no convictions that fit the criteria we were looking at. Harmon had no convictions. And those are the same prosecutorial district. That's the only prosecutorial district that had none by the standards we were looking at. We held all of the counties in the state the same standard. I believe the numbers were very low on Franklin County and a few of the other ones in the area. So you certainly see some rural counties around us. What did you see as far as the differences in accessibility as you talk with other people in your line of work? The experience is going to be different in different places.
Yeah, absolutely. So in North Carolina, there's over 80 rural counties, and we are surrounded by quite a few. And last year we had patients come from 12 to 15 different counties around us to get services here in Mecklenburg County. So it's definitely an issue when you're living in a rural environment that you're already geographically isolated from healthcare needs in general, and to have decreased access to forensic nurses in North Carolina just magnifies that decreased access to care. I think one of the things that we can do really echoes what Mary had stated earlier, is to really support people with their needs, like where they are. So really supporting them and getting access to the sources that are available. So I know, in or out, if it's a transportation barrier, we will get that transportation to us. So supporting them with transportation, supporting them with education too. If they are uninsured, underinsured, and driving an hour or so to get healthcare, and they're concerned about the healthcare bill that they might receive after that, not knowing that these services after a sexual assault are free and they are not ever going to be charged for that, that could also be a barrier. So they may not, want to seek services at all because they don't know what's out there and what is available to them. So certainly education, and even here in Wake County, we are, trying to educate community members so that when somebody does disclose to them, that first contact is so important in the impact on what that patient is going to do. If they're even going to go forward to see a healthcare professional, or if they're going to speak with an advocate, that first contact is vital in their healing and what they decide to do next. So just educating our community members. I think also, looking at telehealth for healthcare needs in general, if we're going to look at, telehealth in some of the rural areas, I think forensic nursing, medical forensic specialists really need to be a part of that so that we can provide that care, we can provide that advice to healthcare professionals and start that conversation with patients.
Representative Beasley, what's your response to our investigation? And I'm wondering if you can tell us if you see any potential for additional legislative action to address some of those concerns.
So, number one, I would say, I'll start in reverse. Can we do more? Absolutely. I don't want anyone to confuse what our legislative efforts are and what they are not. What they are and what they will continue to be is a step in the right direction. They are moving the ball forward. They are creating relationships so that when the next issues arise, have people that we've worked with on these issues, they're more knowledgeable, they're more in-depth, and they're more comfortable with these there that people deal with every single day that are walking around that you will never know that they dealt with this. Bringing up these statistics and bringing up what's happening in our judicial system and what's happening for these people oftentimes can lead to results not just in legislation, but also just in the fact that people are going to feel more empowered to talk about topics that are not comfortable to discuss for the person who it's happened to and for the listener.
Mary, one of the things, as I understand it, with domestic violence agencies at the county levels, I know you all work with those agencies. Many of those agencies are a combination of domestic violence and sexual assault agencies. In some cases, they're also doing child sex crimes. And so, in some counties, you'll have three different agencies dealing with those. But as you coordinate with those agencies, what are some of the things that you see that are happening at the state level to help to improve the process for victims of whatever type of crime in this nature we're talking about?
Well, certainly all of those agencies, whether they're domestic violence agencies, all of the agencies, whether they're domestic violence focused or sexual assault focused, need more resources and more staff. They're under-resourced. Monika will tell you that there is a need for a real distinction and making sure that sexual assault services don't get lost when agencies are offering both domestic violence and sexual violence rape crisis center services. So there, that's a reality. Continuing to promote and build awareness of those services. When we at the Domestic Violence Commission took on the strategy of how do we increase access to services, we realized that just basic information is needed. People still don't know what to do or where to go for help. And so how can we continue to expand knowledge of what's available? That's why we produce the data. The numbers on our website are available to the public. We want to get rid of this concept that it's stranger danger that you have to be aware of and afraid of, and that the data shows that it's who you know who's most often responsible for the assault, and just making the case continually at the state level for solutions that also address prevention. One of the things that I'm proud of is that we are working with agencies like the Coalition Against Sexual Assault on programs that target youth. The Youth Advocates Institute is a very successful program that we're working together with NCCASA on to just provide young people better opportunity to learn to be peer leaders, because young people will listen to young people, and that's the education that's needed. So whether you're talking about family violence, teen dating violence, or domestic violence, we really need more resources. We need more opportunities for information across the state so that people know where to go for help when the disclosure happens, and that we can get rid of the stigma that's still attached to the crime.
Amanda, you've been working at the crime lab for quite a while, and you've got a depth of experience, I hear. Can you tell us what it about the time it takes to process a rape kit and how that's improved since you started working?
But I've been with the state for 20 years and with the crime laboratory for 18. And the bulk of my career has been in the forensic biology department, 15 of those 18 years. So, for information, I will say that over the years we have definitely lessened our time for the processing of the sexual assault kit. How have we done that? As time progresses,
even across the state. We often also is in a role of playing the primary person of contact, giving support to that person in addition to investigating. In training, how do you work with officers to be able to balance this?
So, and I'm glad you mentioned that, and Lauren said something earlier that made me think of the word resources. I've been training police officers in 2007, both in the field and in the academy, and especially with recruits in my car, I would tell them, I never want to hear you say the words, there's nothing I can do for you, or that's not my problem. They are calling you for help, they are trusting you to have answers for something, even if it isn't the law enforcement issue, they are trusting you to have that knowledge as a public servant. And so what I would tell them to do is make a list. Mine started out on the back of a ticket book, a list of names, phone numbers of someone that can help. And we all in here know that knowledge is power. We've seen that on NBC, the commercial, the more you know. And I worked for a rural agency. I worked for an agency where there were three officers for an 800 square mile patrol responsibility at one time. And I can say that, and I'm not trying to sound harsh, but ruralism is not an excuse for not having those resources. And I encourage officers, I train officers to take that initiative to establish those resources. Even if you have to do it yourself, don't wait on a lieutenant, a captain, an administrator. Do it yourself and use the back of the ticket book if you have to. Names and phone numbers and business cards with someone that can help in that area. Now, we have talked quite a bit about trauma, and officers are now being trained, and I'm glad to hear you say that we've been experiencing that for 20 years. The trauma is not anything new, we're just now getting there. And I'm coming from a state, not singing Florida's praises, trust me, I'm coming from a state that was very proactive on that for some reason. So officers are now being trained in trauma-informed interviewing techniques. Well, what is that exactly? So the officer is being trained to understand trauma, first of all, to understand how victims will present during trauma, and how to interview them effectively during that trauma, and also how to collect evidence effectively during that trauma. It can be something as simple as tone of voice. Inadvertently, officers, rightly so, because we have authority, and we're supposed to sometimes stand over people to assert that authority. Well, we inadvertently do that with victims as well, not realizing that we could be adding to that trauma as an authoritative figure standing over them. So, trauma-informed interviewing includes, if officer safety permits, getting on their level, making eye contact with them. Trauma-informed active listening skills, which is a big thing that we've used for years in hostage negotiations. Now we're figuring out, hey, that works in trauma-informed interviewing. And active listening is exactly that. Listening, letting the person know that you're listening. That goes a long way. And I watched a video recently that I'm going to be using in a domestic violence course that I'm doing in May that Charlotte Mecklenburg put on. And one of the advocates said there in that video, most victims just want to hear from law enforcement, I'm sorry this happened to you. I'm sorry this happened to you. That can go a long way. Now, with that being said, officers must also understand that officer safety and scene integrity, crime scene integrity, are just as important as victim cooperation if they want to put together a full case. Sometimes officers may come in and it may seem like they're coming in, taking charge and doing certain things, and the victim is put on the back burner. I can tell you right now that depends on how fluid the scene is. If it's an active crime scene, if the suspect may still be on scene, if there's multiple perpetrators, the officer has, first of all, a safety priority for the victim and for themselves before they can attend to the victim's needs. So they're trained. That oftentimes, though it may appear that the victim is being put aside, That's the unfortunate consequence of an act of crime scene.
Monika, we heard from Amanda about how the State Crime Lab has changed its processes to improve the processing of rape kits. And I'm wondering if you could talk to us about what impact you have seen at your organization.
Impact to?
On victims, on survivors who have gone through this, and what this type of change at the Crime Lab means to them.
So I will actually say that is one of the things that they've changed a while ago and probably haven't been brought to light yet in this story. So I will upload that. When I first met Director Burr, I think he felt charged to show me exactly all the things that they had changed. And I would say it's probably 7-8 years ago, probably. So I think that's important to look up because one of the things that happened in 2009 when we initially started talking about backlog, we were actually talking about backlog at the Crime Lab. Director Burr was brought in. I'm not sure how, magic. All the robots that are there, but when I went, there were no backlog of rape kits, and that's when, I mean, to the process that Amanda just spoke through, we were actually able to say to our rape crisis center, actually they did a newsletter that we actually sent out to all of our rape crisis centers to share with survivors. We shared it with all of our state nurses and all the hospitals that actually outline the things that Amanda just outlined. So while she's talking about them, they're not really new. That is the one thing that we were able to see significant change to very quickly by the same highlight in 2009 around the backlog of kids when they were, at that time, before Director Burns' tenure, were actually at the Crime Lab. And I would say that was a huge turnaround. The fact that we then also understood and shared with prosecutors, because some of our prosecutors didn't actually know that they could request to expedite on behalf of law enforcement. So what we found in this process is there were several pieces that there's the assumption that because you're a professional that you know this, but there's not a professional up here that doesn't, other than me. and Laura, I think we only do this work, but there are other pieces of the work that they're working on. And so for me, what I have to realize is not every prosecutor, not every law enforcement, if they are not readily always doing sexual assault cases, then they don't actually understand what the process is. And so that was eye-opening, and I would say one of the biggest changes. At the same time, we also created what we now call anonymous reporting. And so we also worked with the Crime Lab, and what does this mean? How long can we preserve evidence? And so the state also has a lab where, and Paul, you spoke to this, because law enforcement often say, do you want to move forward with this case at the hospital at the time the kid is collected, at the time of the most high trauma that a survivor is going through at that moment? And what we put in place at that time was to give survivors the opportunity to say, I don't know, but I still want the evidence collected because I'm here, but I don't know what I want to do with it. And I think that is a huge change that again, back to survivors also don't know because nobody plans to be sexually assaulted. So nobody looks up what resources will be available if they're sexually assaulted. And so awareness is still a huge piece of the work that we do in conjunction with all the prevention work we do. And I think I would say those are the changes that we primarily see. Again, Paul's job, it actually started out as a grant, and we worked really hard at that time with the Justice Academy to actually make this position permanent. Because what we see is that when somebody like Paul or at the Crime Lab that are dedicated to sexual assault, that we actually see change in the profession. It's the same thing for Itzy Casa. We exist to create the change in our profession as well for advocates. The North Carolina Association of Forensic Nurses were actually born out of Itzy Casa's office because I'm not a nurse, and we were actually creating the training out of our office. And what we realized is there needs to be a professional organization for sexual assault nurse examiners who could also move forward new science, new technology, and new methodologies that actually move forward what survivors need to actually have the most trauma-informed response once they're sexually assaulted. And then I could talk all day about the prevention work, but I think those are the pieces that I would say we've definitely seen in terms of change regarding after a person is sexually assaulted.
And Frank and Kate, we want to open it up to questions. And I'm Stephanie, I'm the News and Community Partnerships Manager, and we want all of you to feel like you can ask questions. I'm going to start by asking one that came in from online. There's people that are watching our live stream of this. This is from someone out of the Charlotte area. And she says she's a survivor from Mecklenburg County. And DNA, and this is for Amanda, by the way. So sorry. DNA appeared in her lab results, for which she has no explanation. Her case was dismissed by the Mecklenburg County DA's office. She wants her kit retested outside of the lab in Charlotte, and she wants to know how she can make that happen. And secondarily, she wants to know how often a kit is contaminated in the lab. And so those are, we'll start out with that, and then, and again, if any of you are thinking of a question, we'll be coming to you. I apologize. I am just the messenger.
Could you give me the first half of
yes.
Question,
her first half is she presented her issue where her there's DNA that came back in her kit that had no explanation, and that's how she explains it, and it was dismissed, and so she wants to have it retested, and she wants to know how to even go about doing that. And her follow-up question was, how often is a kit contaminated in the lab?
I do not have specific statistics on that. However, I will tell you that we have a quality management program in the laboratory that monitors every discipline. Obviously, DNA is very sensitive technology. There are things that can surface. And so those are all documented through our quality management system. But there is not a high rate of contamination.
I was wondering, I heard that Charlotte Mecklenburg had their own lab. Do they have their own lab, and are the rape kits tested there?
Charlotte Mecklenburg does have their own crime laboratory, and yes, they do perform their own analysis on sexual assault kits.
How often, how typical is that across the state? Do you see that with other municipal agencies?
We do not. That's pretty much the exception.
Okay. We see again. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Hi, thank you for the amazing work that you've done to continue to shine light and all the work that you all continue to do. But thank you to the Carolina Public Press for covering this. Been an advocate for a long time for women and girls, and I have two questions based on two different remarks. One, did you find, this is for the reporters, were there any disparities in terms of race, in terms of which cases were more likely to not reach a conviction or be dismissed? Are there any disparities that we may need to be mindful of, or
we didn't conduct analysis for that. We suspect that that's the case, and it's something we can go back and do additional analysis of. We were looking broadly. We think that's something worth looking at. Mm-hmm. And I'll say there are two ways to look at that that I think are both valid. I mean, a little bit about the history of the state, unfortunately. Both is a disparity based on who the defendant is and disparity based on who the victim is.
Right, and I'm just thinking about Kimberly Crenshaw's earlier work. And then the other thing is, when I got really involved, I'm a member of the Durham Women's Commission and also the Director of Policy and Advocacy for NAMI North Carolina. And so I know that there's a correlation and a link between mental health and trauma, and particularly sexual assault, where we see some concerns around women and men, and also early entrance into the criminal justice system. And there was a case that was brought to my attention in Durham that really forced me into this world of being mindful about the connection between mental illness and sexual assault. The Lakia Boxley case, where she was dismembered and her offender had carried some of her bones in a backpack back in 2013, that case in Durham. Her sister found me somehow out of South Carolina, and one of the things she said was that her sister had a long-term addiction problem that was created from being raped as a child, and as a young teenager, sorry, not a child, but little child, but And she was, and the people were never prosecuted, and that stayed with her, and she felt that that led her down this troubled path. And so I want to ask about this connection between offenders who, or survivors who experience sexual assault as teenagers, as children, who later decide that I do want to get some help and possibly prosecute. Is there a statute of limitation that still remains on the books for when that can happen?
The reason I would say go ahead is, and I have to be honest with you, I'm still learning North Carolina law, so I can't fairly say what the statute of limitation is in North Carolina for that. Florida's fine.
Is this statute of limitation? And that question came up last night in our form of Fayetteville. Somebody from Georgia asked and said, this is a five-year statute. Georgia also, like, not on felonies in North Carolina, there's no statute of limitation.
So two things I'll add to that, which that is the biggest thing that I always tell people, that's the best statute North Carolina has, is the one that we have done better than any other state in the union. Literally, states are fighting since the Penn State to change their statute of limitations, and for criminal penalties, we don't actually have that as a barrier in North Carolina. One of the things, and Mary looks like she has the stats from Rape Crisis Centers in front of her, but I would say that's the largest number of sexual assault survivors that call our crisis line, is adults who are now seeking services who were child or adolescent survivors who either disclosed and were not believed and didn't seek services or were able to seek services because they were minors, or those who never disclosed to anyone at all. And I will say to you, 20 or 25 years ago when I first took the crisis line call, I had no idea that that's what I would be expecting on the other end of the call, for people who never disclosed their sexual assault. They're now adults. And so for Rape Crisis Center, active listening is a key part of the work that we do because we often have people disclosing for the first time. The other piece, most people know that I also work in the education arena, and so we talked a lot about adverse childhood experiences, ACEs we called it. We talked about it as childhood trauma and the impact that it has when young people are sexually assaulted. And so with our college campus work, a researcher actually at UNCG did the work for us, and it's published that if someone is sexually assaulted before the age of 18, they're twice as likely to be sexually assaulted between the ages of 18 and 24. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's important that we also, when we talk about prevalence, we also talk about how vulnerable young adults are if they are sexually assaulted as children, and especially without intervention services. And so that's also a key part of the work that we do, is recognizing if we don't intervene and seek and provide the support needed for young people, then we are twice as likely. And I will tell you, our college campus works absolutely validates that research study, is most of the clients that we provide services for, legal services, also disclose their sexual assault in childhood or adolescence.
So counseling is one of those services that Rape Crisis Center do provide. So counseling is one of those services that's available to individuals who go to Rape Crisis Center, whether it's inside the agency or outside the agency, because we realize that it is a need, and it is definitely vital, and it is an area where there is a need for more resources to do mental health counseling, and also support groups for children. Part of the statistics that we gather show us that 18% of the people who serve in support groups are children. And then your race question, 21% of the individuals who were served just during the past 6 months at Rape Crisis Centers were African American.
21%. I think we have one question right here.
I'm going to stand because I tend to be very loud to start with. Mm-hmm. I am a survivor. And this question is to the reporters. Did you find a gender discrimination? Because I know from being a military sexual trauma survivor that we have a tendency that on same-sex rape, we brush it. And I live in a rural county where I've had this conversation with the sheriff, the district attorney, the chief judge, and when it's same sex, it's looked at totally differently. especially when it involves people of power and authority. So did you find any correlation?
If I remember correctly, that was not something we could not look at gender and victims, right?
Right, there's very little victim information in the state database. You really have to drill down, and a lot of times, I mean, the majority of the time, there's hardly any in there at all.
We could look at gender of the defendant.
Sure.
Not of the victim.
Mm-hmm.
In this particular set of data we reviewed, which is administrative office of the courts.
I think I can say this because I'm not a reporter, and I talked to Kate at length about this. We look at the administrative office of the courts data every year as a coalition, and we finally stopped drilling down the data because in order to actually find the information that people are asking around race, around gender, around type of sexual violence, we literally have to go pull the jacket sleeve of the actual case. Because AOC keeps very broad data, it's also a very complicated Excel spreadsheet. So you really can't actually see the data of the crime. When we try to look at what type of service do we need, we look at the services that are at crisis centers you see, but for us, in order to talk about prosecution, we actually need to see what's currently going through the criminal legal system, and we actually can't tell that just by looking in the AOC data. It is not inextricably this person's race, gender, type of crime that started. You also still have to find this very fine thin line to if it might fit first-degree forcible rape by all the elements of the statute. It's hard to tell by the time it was actually tried for as indecent liberties. That is not a clear straight line that you can actually see in the data, and so it is also a large part of the conversation as we talk about this that the data is also extremely convoluted.
I want to piggyback a little bit on that because I think the data you're referring to is the stuff that's available publicly on the website. Is that correct?
No. Yeah.
Oh, you tried to look at the stuff that I
had? Yeah, Patrick's in
there.
Oh. Okay. That's how I knew it was.
All right, well, I mean.
But you have to literally extract it.
Well, when we looked at getting it to the Excel spreadsheet, how long did it take to get it to that point?
Well, I mean, to get it reliably there, and I also had to look through hundreds of different columns of data. If you think of a spreadsheet, I'm all the way out to like column XX or whatever.
Yes.
Just as an example, that's not actually how it worked, but it took me several months to understand finally what I was looking at.
We had Kate had to run through a special script.
Right. I don't know if anybody knows Python or SQL, I use both of those to
God bless you.
Get this in there. So, yes.
And just to jump in here, too, I think it's also important to remember that one of the fundamental rules of statistics is that the data you get out is only as good as the data you put in. And one of the issues that we have in North Carolina is that our statutes are heavily gendered and include a lot of gender stereotypes.
Absolutely.
And the charges that are then very gendered legal code reflect the stereotype. So even if you had perfect data downstream, because of the way our laws are currently written, you're going to get unreliable data to at least a great extent. We talked a little bit earlier about some of the things that we can fix. I think that everyone in this room could agree, whether you're liberal, conservative, moderate, whatever along the spectrum, that if we were starting from scratch in 2019, we'd have a very different statutory construction for our laws. But given that we have what we have, oftentimes we are trying to repair things and close loopholes, and that gets us better in a better position, but it doesn't get us to the perfect position. And it can be very difficult to extract a lot of those stereotypes that are already built in. We can always do better, but it does mean that even if we get reliable data, you have to be a critical consumer of that data.
Yeah, and that's one reason is when we're doing our evaluations, if we found counties with very, very low numbers of defendants and there were a few, which made us ask some questions there, but primarily looking at convictions. But if we found counties with very low numbers of defendants, we just said, we're not going to evaluate this county. If the county has one defendant and they were convicted or not convicted, does that really tell us anything about that county, for instance? Or if a county has no defendants, we're going to have to divide by zero to get a conviction, because that's kind of a problem. We've treated those as insufficient data to evaluate when we have those. We feel like there are probably probably some errors. We've identified some correctly as we found them, but if there were errors that were input errors, they're going to be mostly spread out, and so we know there's some in the data. But there was one point in the process, and I'm not saying that anybody actually did this, but I'm just mentioning my frustrated remark as we were working on this. I said, you know, if you were doing this and you wanted to design a system to show that, yes, I'm gathering data, but make it really difficult to hold yourself accountable, this is what you would do.
And Emily, I think I saw a question from you.
So I was wondering for folks who, I guess this is kind of more of a question for Monika, for folks who are assaulted as children and then come forward and want to know what they can do, I know that the barrier for prosecution is so high, right? Because you need to have a number of
Now, indeed, this isn't easy. The second part of your question, I won't spend a lot as much time on, but I
had a mother who had problems, but the judge recommended that eventually the goal was returned to the mother. She was a survivor herself. Had been, you know, when her spouse got out of prison for trying to kill her after just a few months, he promptly raped her, and this child was the result of that event. He was put into foster care in part because the mother was afraid that the father would come and kill him while he was trying to kill her. He was in foster care in Chesapeake County. The mother died under mysterious circumstances. That's how we got involved in the case, is trying to figure out what happened to the mother. She disappeared and shows up at a hotel in New Jersey dead, in a place in New Jersey you don't normally go on vacation. But in any case, this child, while he was in foster care, had been abused in foster care. And that was mandatory report, of course. He was taken out of the foster care home, but the mother's family wasn't told where he went. They had no idea where he was. And so after her death, we were trying to investigate what happened to your grandson, to your nephew. His mother's gone. What happened to him? Was this ever prosecuted that he was abused in the foster care system? And to turn off, you know, I don't know that we ever got a true story, but the best we got was there was a screw up with the jurisdiction, because the foster care home was right on the line between county and city. The police would investigate and say, oh, that's not us. And they supposedly, if nobody can prove that they did, they supposedly sent a fax to the sheriff's office. The sheriff's office never got it. The DA never knew about it. The DA said, we definitely would have prosecuted it, except that with the evidence we have about any more investigation than that, looks like it was probably a misdemeanor. So the statute of limitations is run out. We're not going to do anything about it now. Well, we finally got to it. We did find out the kid had been adopted without the family knowing, and they wanted him back. But he'd been adopted, he's alive, he's healthy. That's a good result. This is a system that just was broken all the way through.
I think Anna's been really patient here. Sorry.
I was just wondering, what is the status? You mentioned the $2 million for the rape kit backlog, and I know that Attorney General Stein proposed the Survivors Act. I'm just wondering, what's the status of that? Because I was trying to get $6 million to clear it.
Along the same line, could you give us the number of the bill that you spoke about?
Yeah. Yes, it's House Bill 393.
Thank you.
And the Survivor Act in the House, I believe, is House Bill 29.
That's right. Just not just seeing this national.
just thinking off the top of my head, you know, the front door where nothing, you know, is violated, then you can certainly see who's walking in the front door, and that would help law enforcement with evidence.
Question, follow-up, and I realize this may be outside of any of our expertise. I'm wondering the situation where there's a particular privilege, whether it's a patient privilege or if a lawyer had a client privilege and somebody's assaulted, is that privilege not waived? And then, you know, obviously the person's taken it beyond normal nature of that relationship.
So you're asking if the client assaults the person
yes.
they have a privilege with?
Yeah.
That does not supersede the fact that the crime occurred.
Right, that's what I'm saying. They voided the privilege.
That's
not that old law.
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah.
As long as it has something to do with that assault, I mean, then, you know, obviously they can't disclose things that are not related.
Right.
And just as a lawyer, from a legal perspective, even in the, you know, we have a code of professional conduct in North Carolina as lawyers, so privilege is not a blanket that you can use to cover a multitude of sins. It is very much just meant to foster a collaborative environment where a client feels comfortable talking with their lawyer because their lawyer really needs the full scope. So you see that with a lot of forms of privilege. You know, in North Carolina, we have a lot of forms of privilege that are understandable and that most people know about, and we have some that folks don't necessarily know about. Exactly, even Siri agrees. But so it's very important to remember that, you know, privilege can be a very legally complicated thing, and I'm not going to charge y'all $500 an hour to tell you all the answers. But just know that privilege hardly ever can cover a future crime. It can if you did something, you can tell your lawyer that you did something. But you can't use the fact that you can tell your lawyer something to do something else. I think that's the step that operates when it comes to privilege and how privilege works. So if someone is coming in trying to take advantage of you, number one, I hate that you had to even deal with that. But number two, that is not an excuse, and it's not a legal excuse, and it's not a moral excuse for them to do that to you.
So again, you've heard this, and I want to repeat. Thank you for your courage for sharing it in this space, and definitely sorry that it's happened to you. And so I've actually had this come to me from a massage therapist, but I will say for other boards we have this. So I will tell you, I talked to our general practitioners and dentists, which has been the oddest in my career, that those are the top two professions where we get a lot of reports around sexual assault that happens. And so that's the other thing that I think might be worth, for me as an advocate, my wheels are turning. I'm like, okay, so I can see where we might be able to get this into a tracking bill. I can see where we might be able to talk to massage licensing board. So I do want you to know that I don't think any of us have a direct, solid answer other than I do agree nothing covers a crime that's been committed. No type of privilege. And so we want to make sure all survivors listening hear that and understand that it is a crime and you can still call law enforcement. If that's the route that a person chooses to take. But I do want you to know that my wills are turning and Representative Beasley will probably hear from me, and I just need a good sleep cycle. because sometimes it is processed, and I think what Paul said is a good practice for your employer. But I'm thinking about, for somebody who spends a lot of time in a spa and a salon, because I get a lot of services, as you can tell, that require me to go to those facilities. Those are places where people aren't asking for my name, they're not asking for identification. And so I don't think it's something that's ever come to me directly. And so I'm definitely thinking about kind of, even if it's not a statute, is it administrative rules that we can take a look at as well. I'm going to charge Representative Beasley to sleep on it too.
I'm going to have to run in a minute, and I talk all the time, so please, you can just tell me to be quiet. But I just want to say thank you both gentlemen, or all three of you, just for putting your time and your energy and your sincere interest and compassion behind this issue. For so long, so many women and girls, you know, Oprah's character, Sophia, girl child just ain't safe in a house full of men. I always say, that's true, girl child just ain't safe in this world controlled by men. And then now with our top leader not showing leadership around this issue, and I'll just leave it at that. But thank you, and I feel you almost brought tears to my eyes when you were responding to her. And that's the kind of compassion we need to protect girls, boys, and those who, you know, whatever the gender identity is, from this horrific experience that can change the trajectory of a person's life. And then I want to ask the reporters, I don't know who's done studies on women in prison before they close the Fountain Correctional Facility. I used to take that drive two times a week when I was teaching at North Carolina Central to go there to teach college transfer courses back in 2009. And because I love to talk, I leave like the last 10 minutes of my class just to chat with the ladies, just to talk. And one day I asked the question, how many of them had experience, and this is because I was working on a piece at the time, a sexual assault. And all but like two of the ladies raised their hands. So I would be interested to know, in our prisons, how many women are in North Carolina prisons that have experienced sexual trauma in some form, whether it was a sexual assault as a child or as an adult. So I'd like to charge that as your next piece that you do.
It's a great question. I will share with you, been working on some additional research. I've already done some reporting on treatment of inmates in 10 and 12 jails, not specifically with sexual assault, although that's really part of what we're looking at. But we're looking at inmate mistreatment, either by other inmates or by personnel or by other inmates at request of personnel. We've looked in particular at one facility where there's been some concerns, but we're going to be continuing to look at issues of inmate mistreatment.
Well, this, let me be clear, this was not, this was prior to.
One
thing I'd like to hit on that real quickly is the Prison Rape Elimination Act that was passed in 2002 provides very rigorous quality assurance and standards for jails and prisons to go through, and they're audited annually, sometimes semi-annually, and so that may be a resource that you can look into. But again, the problem with any sexual assault data is victim information is very limited on purpose for protection of the survivors. So, yeah. But that's it's PREA for short, Prison Rape Elimination Act, is something we may want to look into for a resource on that.
And we have a question. I've been very patient.
I want you to clarify something for me. I thought I heard you say that in 2009 there was no backlog. Is that true? And then in 2019 there are 15,000 backlog kits? And
I think there's two different backlogs we're talking about.
Oh, okay.
One is at the state lab, is that correct? The original was the state lab that was wiped out in 2009. And then the backlog you might have heard about last year, it's the worst of the nation, is individual agencies throughout the state who have rape kits on the shelves or wherever that have gone untested. And that's the one that's been the more recent concern.
Well, a couple of you have said that you've spent 15 or 20 years at this. Do you have any idea about why this happened? Or over, you do? Could you speak to that?
I should let the representative, because I've been so good on this panel. I really don't have anything nice to say here, and so my grandmother would say, don't say anything at all. I mean, quite frankly, the letters that we received, and these were from people who were actually looking for other evidence and found rape kits all types of places that they shouldn't have been in storage rooms, somebody who was a law enforcement officer. Sent me a picture of a rape kit that was dated 5 years prior in the refrigerator where their lunch was. Mm. So we had kits anywhere you can imagine. And this just isn't in North Carolina, but this particular picture was from a North Carolina local law enforcement agency. They were in prosecutor's office, they were in hospitals, and so this is live streaming, so Lieutenant Sutherland can call me and tell me I'm not quoting him correctly. But I mean, quite frankly, my career has been, we did not have people who believe sexual assault survivors.
That's
and
right.
So those kits were treated like boxes and not like human being evidence within them. And so wherever that process stopped is where that kit landed. And if it landed somewhere that needed to be moved because something else needed to happen, it got moved somewhere else because it needed to be space. And so I would definitely say, you know, and I think the oldest, that actually was asked today in the judiciary hearing on the Senate side on this bill, like what was the oldest kit? And there wasn't an answer today, but we actually had a law enforcement agency who was FOIA'd before this became into our statewide survey, that they had a kid that was 29 years old. 29 years old. And what I can tell you is when law enforcement were initially North Carolina was FOIA'd by another national organization that I worked with, and they FOIA'd 5 law enforcement agencies, and they all told us they had no kids that were backlogged. And then when they were FOIA'd, and we got like kind of how they classified those kids, there was definitely like backlogs, and I mean, even law enforcement agencies who I've worked with literally for several years who had done trainings for us for other law enforcement agencies had kits on their shelves. And when asked about it, most of them just said, oh, this is one that, you know, we asked the survivor, she said she didn't want to go, so we just left it here. Or this is one that we don't have enough evidence, so it's just sitting here. So there were so many reasons, but I still personally will say to you, and I've said this publicly, and so I'm not ashamed to say it, but it is advice, I don't think people believe survivors. And so it was easy to make this a box that we just put down. And I'm going to let the person say.
I have one more, I know we're getting short on time, but I have one more issue that I want to talk about, and that's the revocation of consent issue in North Carolina. North Carolina is the only state in the country where if you begin an act consensually that you can't tell the person to stop and then later have them charged as rape. And I've heard some horror stories about this and reporting this, and that men take their condoms off in the middle of the act and they continue and they can't be prosecuted for rape. Or even there's apparently some places in the state where if you're just fooling around, the guy thinks that's licensed to continue with, you know, escalating the act. So I'm hoping that we can get some comment from our representative here and anyone else on the panel who would like to address it.
Yeah, absolutely. So number one, I think that this is an issue that definitely has to be addressed. I can tell you that this is a discussion that we've had on multiple occasions because it is something that needs to be fixed, and the fix basically has to be legislative. I will also say that oftentimes in the General Assembly there are 170 of us, so